Welcome to Someone Talked, the official podcast of the National D-Day Memorial, where leading experts spill all the secrets of the Second World War with your host, Dr. John C. McManus.
Greetings. Welcome to Someone Talked. I'm your host, Dr. John C. McManus, Curator Distinguished Professor of U.S. Military History at Missouri S&T. And alongside me, as always, are my friends April Cheek Messier and John Long of the National D-Day Memorial. How are you guys today?
So happy to be talking with you again, John.
Great to be here. Looking forward to this conversation about a great book.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. Yeah. So our guest in this episode is James Scott, who is a personal friend of mine. But I just I really want to give you a sense of James's background and his achievements. He is really one of the leading historians of World War II. He's someone who really understands how to bring a really good blend of scholarship and remarkable storytelling and writing ability to his work. James, similar to me, has a journalism background. James actually was a investigative reporter for the Charleston Post and Courier. I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, James, you were also a war correspondent in Afghanistan, correct?
I was.
Yep. So he's authored five books, of which the one we'll discuss in this episode is called Black Snow, Curtis LeMay, The Firebombing of Tokyo, and The Road to the Atomic Bomb, which, in my opinion, is a remarkable piece of work. But a little bit in terms of the background, James is also a Nieman Fellow at Harvard. He has an MA in military history from the Citadel. As I mentioned, this is his fifth book. His previous books have had some pretty serious honors. A book he wrote called The Attack on the Liberty, which is about the Israeli attack on the USS Liberty in 1967 during the Six-Day War. Got the Samuel Eliot Morrison Award, which is really the leading award in naval history. And James's father was aboard that ship. His book Target Tokyo was a Pulitzer Prize finalist, which is an incredible achievement. And very, very well deserved. And his book Rampage, which is about the Battle of Manila, and really was like the first book to look at that battle in any kind of real depth, was a finalist for the extraordinarily prestigious Gilder Lehrman Prize. So, so this is the kind of background James brings to the table, and he's turned his attention now to the bombing of Japan, primarily in 1945, and. You know, I would say this is a side of the war that isn't looked at in the kind of depth it should be. And when it tends to be through the lens of the atomic bomb. But James is focusing primarily on the initial firebombing of Tokyo, but giving you the broader scope of the background. So I guess my first question to you, James, is, you know, what led you to take on this topic? Why did you do this particular book?
Yeah, John, thanks so much for having me on the show. And it's you're a dear friend, and so it's great to get together and chat like this. So, you know, it's funny. I was about 10 years ago, I was working on a book called The War Below, which was about the submarine war in the Pacific. And several of these submariners that I was following were actually in this Tokyo area prisoner of war camp in Camp Omori, which, you know, was this island right there in Tokyo Bay. And so they experienced this firebombing of Tokyo on the night of March 9th and early morning of March 10th, 1945. And so I wrote about it through their perspectives. And I remember thinking at the time, like, wow, this is just an insane mission. I mean, you know, the level of destruction and whatnot. I mean, you know, we always hear about Hiroshima and Nagasaki and whatnot, but yet here you have just this conventional raid that burns 16 square miles of Tokyo, leads to 100,000 deaths, and just totally overshadowed. And so I made kind of a mental note, come back to this story. And you know, granted, it took me 10 years to get back to it, but here we are. And I'm glad I got back to it when I did, you know, because it gave me an opportunity, you know, to actually, with another project, Target Tokyo, to look at the beginnings of the American air war against Japan through the lens of Jimmy Doolittle and his men. So kind of gave me an opportunity to sort of set the stage for this next project. So.
Yeah. And James, you were talking a little about the civilian perspective, and I think that's what makes your books, you know, really stand out, because you really go into depth with what the civilians were, what they experienced. Can you talk a little bit about, because I know in those interviews, and first of all, that's so important, I think, to have that perspective, you know, Black Snow is a book that truly is full of human tragedy, and it's difficult to read in parts because you hear what they're going through. Can you talk a little bit about what it was like to interview those individuals and to write about it as well? I'm sure it was a very emotional process.
Yeah, absolutely. No, and I mean, the civilian experience is something that I think, you know, John and I, we do a lot of World War II history, and it often gets overlooked in military, in strict military histories, but it's a big part of the experience of war. You know, the Battle of Manila, for example, I mean, 100 civilians died for every one U.S. Soldier, you know, and same thing with Tokyo. I mean, this was a raid that was largely borne on the backs of the men, women, and children of Tokyo. And so I think that is an important perspective to bring. You know, when I was working on this book, so I spent time in Tokyo. And there is, fortunately, there is a private museum in Tokyo that's dedicated solely to this one raid. And it's an amazing three-story structure. It's got artifacts from the war. I mean, it's got, coins that are fused together, roof tiles that are fused with dishware and things like that. And they've got a really terrific library. And through that museum, they also bring in survivors of that raid. Talk to school children and members of the public. And so I was really fortunate when I was working on this book to, they loaned me their conference room for interviews. And then, so I did interviews there. And then also I did interviews in karaoke booths with a lot of people, which Japan is, this is kind of one of the things. Japan, of course, is, and I used to live in Japan. I should mention that. My first job out of college was as an English teacher over there. And so I'm familiar with Japanese culture and the love of karaoke. And all over Tokyo, there are all these karaoke businesses, and they have these, you know, basically like these, like a living room. You've got plush sofas and tables. You've got soundproof rooms. They're really terrific places to do interviews because, you know, you're meeting on neutral ground. Somebody doesn't feel like, hey, I'm inviting a historian into my home. I can just go meet them at the local karaoke place, and you can be in there for hours. You have snacks while you're there, and it's a really conducive environment. To do this, I will say I had phenomenal cooperation from so many of these folks, and these were very painful interviews in a lot of ways. One of the things that's not appreciated, I think, in looking back, is that a lot of the children at that time between the ages of third grade and sixth grade were evacuated outside of the city, and so they were kept in inns and resorts and things like that in order to save them in case there were firebombing. So this massive attack actually led to lots and lots of Japanese orphans. And so I interviewed several people who were orphaned by this raid. You know, they lost their parents, they lost their siblings and whatnot. And, one of the folks I interviewed, Mrs. Nagata, I mean, she was outside of the city when it happened. She lost her family. And she brought to that interview the last letter she ever received from her sister. And her sister actually, in the letter was written right before, just a couple of days before the raid. And in fact, LeMay, before he flew the raid on the night of March 9th, actually had flown a test mission against Tokyo, a much, much smaller scale mission. And this young girl actually wrote to her sister about seeing it. And she described it with, childlike wonder at watching these incendiaries. They were like sparklers. She said, I knew I would get in so much trouble for this, but they were beautiful. And I'll tell you, it's just, you hear these stories, you read this letter, and it's so heart-wrenching to do that. And, and so this raid, it has this huge ripple effect through so many lives, here we are almost eight decades later, and the effect it had on some of these civilians, it's profound, and it's with them every single day. And so, I quite frankly, I think there wasn't a dry eye in that room between me, players, everybody involved. Those are important stories. That's the that we need to tell.
James, let's go back a few years, say 1935, 1936. If you ask any military leader pretty much anywhere in the world about aviation, they would agree that aviation was going to play a key role in the next war. But what exactly did they think it would be? What was expected of the airplane in a future war at that point? And what did the planners get right? And what did they get wrong about it?
Yeah, you know, and that's one of the things I find so fascinating is, I mean, we kind of take for granted today the dominant role aviation plays, you know, in all of our lives. You know, the ability to just jump on a plane and on the East Coast and be in Los Angeles at the end of the day, you know, 4 or 5 hours later. You know, and at this time period, I mean, it's, you know, aviation is still this really new component to warfare, this new variable. And one of the things that I find so fascinating is Hap Arnold, of course, who is the head of the Army Air Forces. You know, he actually learned how to fly from none other than Orville and Wilbur Wright. So, I mean, he goes from learning how to fly from the Wright brothers to commanding this massive global strike force in the span of just a few decades. I mean, the only reason early aviators even wore goggles, you know, that trademark image you have of aviators, is because a bug hit Hap Arnold in the eye when he was landing one time. And so, I mean, you go from like that to the B-29 and the B-17. I mean, the B-29 is this massive aeronautical monster, you know, with a wingspan that's actually longer than the Wright brothers' first flight, you know, able to bridge these extraordinary distances across the Pacific. So it really is just this transformative element of warfare. That said, of course, it was a challenge. You know, and a lot of time spent between World War I and World War II was trying to figure out what role aviation would play. And, you know, coming out of World War I, where you had just, you know, these awful impact trenches and filled with rats and mud and everything else. I mean, aviation offered this promise of being able to sort of leapfrog over that and turn a whole nation into a battlefield. But there was still challenges. Like, what, you know, what role would aviation play? Would it be, you know, would you try to bomb an enemy, you know, and never have to put boots on the ground? Would it play a co-equal role to the infantry? I mean, so all these were questions that we're kind of wrestling with. And of course, when World War II breaks out is sort of when the rubber meets the road, and when we start to find out that a lot of the ideas that had been talked about during the interwar year may or may not have held up as well as we had hoped they would. And so, and one of the big ones that I think a lot of people had pushed was that aviation would sort of be able to cripple an enemy's economy, much like collapsing a house of cards. And if you kind of came in and if you pinpointed a handful of industries like oil and things like that, then you could collapse an enemy's economy. And it looked great on paper, but when World War II begins, we really realize that the German economy is far more resourceful than we anticipate. They have the ability to grab resources out of occupied countries. They can disperse industry elsewhere. And so it really raises, it becomes a lot more grueling of a fight than I think people had initially heard during the interwar period.
Yeah. So one of the things that's just, you know, great about the new book, Black Snow, is, you know, when you tell the story of the raid, the Tokyo raid, it's not just foisting right on the reader. You're giving the context. So there's a lot of background, you know, on where all this comes from, you know, obviously technologically through the development of the B-29 and Hap Arnold really driving that and the stress behind that. But also, you know, like any good writing, you're personalizing it and you're showing some of the key figures, whether well-known or not. And one of the key, you know, characters, for lack of a better word, in the book is General Haywood Hansel, who in some ways harkens to an earlier age because he's courtly. He's scholarly in a way. He's really more of a staff officer in some ways than you know, a combat leader. And yet, of course, he ends up in command of these bomber forces in the Pacific and unleashing the initial campaign against Japan, you know, in late 1944, early 1945, once the U.S. controls the Marianas. So, you know, what are the issues Hansel is facing? What is he like? And why does this whole thing run afoul for him?
Yeah. Yeah. And John, you bring up a really good point. You know, when I first started this book, I really kind of, you know, as a Pacific War guy, I really just kind of wanted to write the story from the Pacific War. And air war in the Pacific isn't that way. I mean, it goes through Europe. I mean, you can't write about what happens mm-hmm. to Tokyo, Nagoya, Osaka, Hiroshima, all that, without first going through the entire European air war. And so I had to really kind of back up and spend a lot of time getting into that. And because, of course, and Haywood Hansel is sort of at the center of, in so many ways, both of these, because, you know, he is one of the architects of this concept of high altitude daylight precision bombing, which is, you know, we were just talking about a minute ago, which is this idea that an enemy's economy can be collapsed by pinpointing key industries and whatnot, and that it would, in theory, be a much more efficient, faster, and really morally better way to use air power. And of course, he goes into combat in Europe as a commander there, and he struggles because the German, you know, one of the big factors they didn't consider was, you know, the German Air Force, the Luftwaffe. I mean, how would they affect B-17 operations? You know, they were like aerial Rottweilers, man. They just pounced and they attacked. The air war there becomes a much greater slog than I think anybody had anticipated. And it really kind of exposed, in a lot of ways, sort of the naivete of Haywood Hansel's, you know, insistence on the fact that the B-17 will always get through, that it, you know, it's got armor, it's got guns and whatnot, and that you don't need long-range fighters to be able to accompany it and all that. And he struggles throughout that because, in theory, I mean, in so many ways, he's a planner. He's not a predator. You know, he is better suited for the analytical side of war than he is the combat side, where you have to wake up each morning and you're looking around the breakfast room table and their faces that just aren't there because they didn't make it back. And so he struggles. In fact, he gets passed over for promotion ultimately in the European war. And he's then brought back to the United States, where he then once again falls back into planning and begins sort of building up how America is going to attack Japan, which of course is his strong point. And then he is, of course, ultimately promoted against the wishes of some people in the air service to be the one who's going to lead the air war against Japan. And Hansel, he's a really interesting figure. I mean, he's, as you noted, I mean, he kind of comes from his, like a long lineage of American officers. I mean, all the way back to the Revolutionary War. He was a thinker. He loved Shakespeare. He loved, you know, poetry, wrote his own poetry. He was the unofficial poet of the Air Force. I mean, he had the worst nickname ever, too, and they called him Possum. And he used to like to say that because he was clever and wily, kind of like that backyard varmint when his wife later lets it out that it had far more to do with his facial features than it did anything else. And so, you know, but he was also just a huge believer in it all. And, you know, as you know, too, John, I mean, he's a pack rat, which as historians, we love that because, you know, you go and you look through personal papers out at the Air Force Academy and down in Maxwell. And he wrote all the time. He kept it all. He wrote several. He really just, we can so appreciate all that. So, and John, you would love this too. He retired at Hilton Head Island, South Carolina, which I know is some of your old stomping grounds as well.
Absolutely. Great place. So he definitely had good taste in islands to live.
Well, James, just going back to what you said earlier, just talking about this, obviously, this strategy, your book suggests that LeMay's decision to firebomb civilian areas in Tokyo was a step over the previous line. But the U.S. had already bombed, you know, German and Japanese cities by then, including Dresden. So do you think LeMay's decision to firebomb civilian areas in, did it constitute a break with previous doctrine? And how so?
Yeah, it did. I mean, of course, yeah, the U.S., of course, had flown a lot of the missions in Europe alongside the British. But, you know, you also had a pretty deep bench of American air commanders over there that were really adamant that while the British had eventually given up precision bombing and moved into firebombing German cities, that the U.S. was going to stay that course. And so, for example, I mean, like the Dresden raid, you know, the large damage done that sort of led to the firestorm there was actually done by British bombers, whereas the Americans sort of went after the marshalling yards. And so, in fact, you had Ira Eaker sort of later in 1944 even saying, you know, look, we don't want history to convict us of sort of throwing the strategic bomber at the man on the street. That's not to say that, and some historians have argued that, look, America's, you know, the capability and targeting was not all that grand. But that, you know, so there were civilian deaths as a result of all this. But intent really kind of matters here, I think, because for the intent of what the 8th Air Force was trying to do was to do precision bomb. And of course, they're not 100% perfect on all that, but the idea was they really did stay true to that. Of course, LeMay then comes over to the Pacific. And of course, Hansel is doing precision bombing against the Japanese, and he's really struggling because of a couple factors that that they weren't expecting. And one of those, of course, is Japan weather. It has horrific clouds. I mean, there are some months where you had literally 3 days of clear weather over Japan. And that was it. I mean, I remember from when I lived there, there was an entire month where it rained every single day. I mean, I just did not understand how there could be this much rain in one place. And so, of course, if you're trying to fly daylight precision bombing, cloudy weather, it's just not going to happen. But even beyond that, they also encountered these.
Still on the screen, but it's frozen.
Yeah, we lost his audio.
I don't think we lost him.
Yeah,
I think. He's left. Because
if we still have Dr. J.
Yeah. It's on his end.
Yeah, I'm here.
His was a little spotty anyway. You can
he's back.
There he is. And,
okay. Yeah, I don't know what happened there. Because I have full bars on my Wi-Fi, I just said lost signal.
Okay.
So
yeah, we hear you now.
You know where you left off?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I'm in South Carolina, man. Yeah, our infrastructure's terrible. So just talking.
Possum would be proud.
No, that's how right. You've been
I can try to kind of pick up where I left off if that works for you guys.
Yeah,
perfect.
We'll make work. Okay, so the war in Japan kind of exposes even greater problems. I mean, and a big part of that, of course, is the cloudy weather. That's just as little as 3 days a month in some cases were clear, which just meant that if you're trying to do daylight precision bombing, you really had very limited windows from which to do it. And on top of that, you also had these really violent jet streams, which were literally over 200 miles an hour that would just really batter the bombers up in the heavens over Japan. So I mean, you had the weather, you had the jet streams and whatnot, and of course, all the other challenges, a brand new bomber and all the bugs that came with the B-29, the primitive bases they had in the Marianas, the Japanese raids from Iwo Jima, and it really just kind of combined to make Hansel's job, just for in his eyes, really insurmountable in a lot of ways. And of course, at this point in the war, patience is really running out. And Hap Arnold is looking to, America's contemplating this big invasion of the Japanese home islands. And Hap Arnold is really wanting us to, the Americans, to really try to bomb the Japanese out of the war before American boots have to touch the ground there. And so there's tremendous pressure on Hansel. So he is ultimately fired literally after just a few months. His crews fly just a handful of missions and Hap Arnold's patience is out. And they bring in LeMay. Now, LeMay, of course, everybody thinks that LeMay immediately begins sort of his firebombing campaign, which is not actually quite accurate. I mean, Hansel and LeMay actually have this meeting when LeMay first gets out there. And you have to remember, they knew each other. They were friendly. I mean, Hansel had actually been LeMay's boss in Europe. When I was going through LeMay's personnel file, over 4,000 pages, there's actually a commendation letter that Hansel wrote on behalf of LeMay, congratulating him for his great work in Europe. And so they knew each other quite well. And here LeMay lands out here, and he suddenly outranks Hansel. He's being brought in to replace him. And they have this meeting. And of course, Hansel's this sort of classic Southern gentleman. And so he doesn't blame LeMay, and he says that to him. But he also says, look, we're going to win this war. In the end, we're not going to be judged on whether we win it. We're going to be judged on how we win. And he really implores LeMay to continue flying these precision raids against him. And LeMay tells him, look, I'm going to keep doing what our strategy, our doctrine is. But I'm open to change if necessary. And so LeMay begins flying his operations, and he's doing the same thing Hansel did. Of course, LeMay has this background in engineering, and he's a problem solver, and he's pragmatic. And so he's, of course, getting the same results that Hansel did. And so he starts tinkering with the equation. What if we bring the bombers down a little bit? What if we move our takeoff times? What if we work on improving our radar operators' skill sets? And he eventually comes to the realization that despite all the changes and tinkering, that he's really unable to make it work with any better results than Hansel got. And that's kind of when he makes the decision, look, I'm going to have to change out. I'm going to have to do sort of a radical change of our playbook here and switch over to firebombing. So I do think it is a pretty big moral shift and a pretty big significant strategic shift at that point, because really up until that point, I mean, that the Air Force doctrine was, you know, high altitude precision bomb. And so LeMay is the one who ultimately changes that out.
James, why was Japan so susceptible to a strategic bombing campaign like this? And at the beginning of the war, did they not know that? Were they unaware of their susceptibility?
Yeah, you know, there's a lot to unpack there. The Japanese, you know, when we think of Tokyo today, if you watch shows like Tokyo Vice and things like that, you see all the steel and glass high rises and the wide boulevards. That was not the Tokyo of 1945. I mean, the Tokyo of 1945 was a sea of one and two story wood framed homes and businesses. They did have sort of a little bit of commercial district, like a financial district, but it almost spread out amongst all these rooftops and whatnot. I mean, it was about 98% of Tokyo was made out of wood and paper. And it is amazing that they didn't think about the potential dangers that they had until much late, and really until too late in the war, considering their history of fires. Now, in 1923, there was a big earthquake and subsequent fire that really burned up much of Yokohama and Tokyo. And it really was just a huge catastrophe. And so when Japan started to rebuild from there, they did add increasing park space. They did try to change their building standards. They did try to add more major roads and things like that. But of course, they ran into a recession, and then they ran into a shortage of building supplies. And ultimately, they fell back on what had worked for centuries and centuries, which was this wood frame construction that was highly susceptible to fire. And the Japanese knew that. And so did the Americans, quite frankly. I mean, LeMay gets a lot of credit for being the one to sort of switch over to firebombing Japan. But that decision didn't really happen in a vacuum. I mean, America had been moving in that direction for quite a while. I mean, you know, the very beginning of the war, you know, we start designing a new incendiary weapon that ultimately is going to be what we use against Japan. In the summer of 1943, we actually went so far as to build a mock Japanese village in the deserts of Utah in order to test this flame weapon. And over the summer of 43, we burned this village out over and over and over again. At the same time, war planners were really looking at Japan's susceptibility to fire in all of its major cities. And in fact, went so far as to bring in some of the insurance adjusters who had worked the 1923 earthquake and fire to interview them to get their opinions on, you know, just what made it burn the way it did. And so through that information, built out target folders that ranked each city by zone based on how flammable certain zones were. So that when LeMay makes that decision in March of 1945 to burn Tokyo, he already has the perfect flame weapon, and he has literally a dossier on every single city there broken down by which parts of the city are most susceptible to fire. But the bigger thing is, like, the Japanese have a real hand in sort of why they could have done so much more. And if they had looked, if they had seen what happened to Hamburg in summer of 43, you know, they'd seen the raids on Berlin and other places, they could have taken greater steps. And they really didn't, which is astonishing considering how susceptible to fire they were. They should have evacuated more personnel outside of the city, aside from just the third through sixth graders. They should have cut more fire breaks through cities. They should have beefed up their fire departments and things like that. But they really just... Instead, they actually they didn't even really do much in the way of digging real shelters for people. They kind of told residents, build your own shelters. And these ended up being foxholes in people's yards. And of course, when you're looking at a massive firestorm, you just don't even have a prayer there. So, I mean, the Japanese really just didn't take any needed steps until far, far too late. And of course, after the fire raid on Tokyo, you then begin to see this mass exodus outside of the cities. Literally 8.5 million people. You see the depletion of urban areas and things like that. The government begins cutting those fire lanes through cities and things like that. But of course, by then, it's too late.
In the meantime, while the Japanese are taking their half measures, LeMay is taking over for Hansel. And LeMay is an interesting, of course, self-made guy. You go into a great deal of background on him in the book. It's quite interesting. You kind of get to know him as a person. But you know, by the time he gets to the Pacific Theater, he's been through a lot in World War II. I mean, he's participated in some of the deadliest raids in Europe. So he's a very courageous combat commander. But boy, he's a thinking kind of guy. And of course, we know him and remember him today for his ruthlessness on a lot of levels, not just World War II, but obviously Strategic Air Command and his chief of staff of the Air Force eventually. And being involved in politics, he has a kind of a hard-edged reputation, which is belied a little bit. And it's one of the many strengths of your book is that you really dehumanize him. But now here he comes into this dealing with this problem. And he comes up with the idea of the firebombing raid on the Japanese capital. And really, there's so much riding on this, obviously, for him personally. But in terms of how the Army Air Forces look at the war, for their concept of the war and how the war is going to end with Japan and all these other things. So that there's enormous, you're sort of chronicling the pressure from the American side, which, of course, pales in comparison to the Japanese who are going to be under these incendiary bombs getting roasted. But at the same time, you really get a sense of that kind of human drama that's playing out. So in the early morning hours of March 10th is when this raid really starts to play out in a major way. I wonder if you could, you know, just sort of tell us, what is that raid like for those who are in it? The civilians in Tokyo, the bomber crews, what's it like that night?
Yeah, and in fact, John, even if we get back up to just touch and talk a little bit about LeMay for that, because I do think, as you noted, he really is just such an interesting character that I think has, because the latter part of his career has unfortunately overshadowed the tremendous effort he made air war during World War II. I mean, LeMay was unlike Hansel, who had sort of come up through the army aristocracy and sort of had, you know, sort of had a lot of sort of ease in a lot of what he did. LeMay was just a bootstrapper. I mean, he grew up dirt poor. You know, his father was sort of a deadbeat who sort of pulled the family all around the country while he did odd jobs and things like that, sort of trying to make a living. And LeMay learned very young that he couldn't rely on anybody, not even his parents. That if he was going to be successful in life, it came down to him. If he wanted to eat, he had to go fish and catch it. You know, if he wanted to put himself through college, he had to do it himself. And he did so by working all night in a steel mill. So, I mean, he's literally out there in these sweltering conditions until 3 and 4 o'clock in the morning, catches a couple hours of sleep, and is in class at 9 a.m. in order to pay his own way through college. So as a result of that upbringing and all that, you know, he didn't get any kind of real social education. He didn't play sports. He didn't date. He didn't have much in the way of friends. And of course, all this kind of combines to sort of bake his personality in. So in a lot of ways, he's pretty reserved and aloof. And he's awkward in these kinds of social situations. And so when he gets into the war, of course, you know, he brings with him this sort of pragmatic, dogged work ethic. And of course, he did study engineering, so he's got this engineering background, problem solving mindset. And he goes off to war, and he does. The war takes a tremendous personal toll on him. And if you go through all of his letters, and it's important for us to remember, I mean, LeMay is 38 at this time, so he's really young. And here he is, you know, a major general, and he goes through this war, and he hasn't seen his family much in years. I mean, he gets a break at one point. He goes back to Ohio for a few days and he sees his daughter. He's got this daughter who's, you know, 4 or 5 years old. And she insists that he goes outside and sits on the front porch swing on this frigid night with him. And they sit out there for an hour and he's like, you know, it's freezing cold. What are we doing out here? And LeMay's wife later says, you know, hey, she wanted to show you off to all the other kids because, you know, they were convinced she didn't have a father. And when you read his letters, there's a theme throughout them all, which is how tired he is. I mean, he writes, he's like, at the end of this war, I'm just going to sleep forever. And there's just an exhaustion and whatnot. And this war is taking this great personal sacrifice on him. But at the same time, he's tremendously successful. He helps with the bomber formations over Europe that improve the safety for air crews. He sort of deciphers the riddle of German flak to show that it's not as accurate as a lot of the early air crews thought. And he gets noticed. You look in his personnel file. I mean, people like Jimmy Doolittle are writing, hey, he's one of the best combat commanders we have. And so he really rises up through the ranks, not based on who he is, but based on his accomplishments. And so, of course, so that's how he ends up in the Pacific. And I do think he is one of those interesting characters whose unfortunate latter part of career overshadows the tremendous work he did. Now, as for that raid on March 9th, I mean, it's extraordinary. You know, I mean, LeMay is being told by his artillery officers that if you go in over Tokyo at 5,000 feet, which he's proposing, you need to be prepared that you might lose as much as 70% of your force. Okay, so that's 2,000 air and 200 bombers. But LeMay, you know, again, sort of that pragmatic problem solver, he's convinced, he's looked at the photographs, he's convinced that the Japanese don't have low-level flak, that their night fighter capability is really weak, and that because for so long America has been flying these high-altitude precision raids during the daytime, that by coming in low at night, you know, under the cover of darkness, it's going to be like an aerial sucker punch. And so he makes that call. And he says it's not, you know, it's not a gamble. It's a calculated risk. And so, of course, the airmen think it's all a suicide mission. And so, you know, they, of course, are convinced that they're being sent off to, you know, never coming back. And so, you know, that creates this huge tension and whatnot. But LeMay's adamant. So they take off at sunset on the night of March 9th, 1945, from Guam, Saipan, and Tinian. And at this point, it's the largest raid America has sent against the Japanese. He's sending every flyable bomber in his armada against the Japanese. And of course, they all take off, fly out, you know, and rather than going formation, they're flying singly. So it's just this huge 400 miles of airspace just covered up by this just monsoon of metal that is coming in over the Japanese. And of course, they reach Tokyo shortly past midnight. And the first bombs start falling at 12:07 a.m. And of course, you know, the Japan at this point, as the air crews are coming in, it's blacked out. You know, they can't see where they're going. The searchlights aren't on yet. The flak isn't firing. It's beginning to. And they kind of come in, and they've got, LeMay has set his target area over about a 12-square-mile rectangle. It actually kind of looks like a jigsaw puzzle piece, kind of the edges on it, if you look at it from the air. And they've got four aiming points, you know, and so the pathfinders are going to come in, start the initial fires, and then everybody else is going to come in after that and hit those spots. So literally for the next 142 minutes, bomber after bomber comes through the skies at Tokyo, unloading these incendiaries. And of course, these incendiaries are designed to plummet down, and they punch through the rooftops, the tile and metal rooftops. And then out of the tail then goes this napalm, this jelly gasoline that covers walls, floors, bedding, and whatnot, and begins these fires. And so literally within half an hour, these early fires just start melding together to build this just massive inferno that covers multiple city districts. And of course, a firestorm like that, all this hot air is just rushing upward. And so nature hates this vacuum. So as the hot air is rushing upward, it's pulling in colder air from the sides. And that colder air, as it's rushing in, literally reaches hurricane wind speeds. So it's toppling utility poles, it's trees, it's strong enough to literally pull babies out of the arms of their mothers. And so this fire becomes literally like a tidal wave, and it's moving leeward across the city of Tokyo. So it's just an absolutely terrifying phenomenon. And when you talk to the Japanese people who survived it, one of the things they always say is, it's how loud it is. That it's like a freight train. That a fire of that intensity is just, it's terrifying. It's a monster. And of course, the air at that point is superheated. So, I mean, people's clothing begins to ignite. Their hair ignites. Sparks are raining down. Your eyelashes are burning. Your eyebrows are melting. And so at that point, then you begin to see all the flaws in Japan's thinking, which is there are no shelters. People get inside these little foxholes or whatnot, and they're roasted, like one survivor said, like potatoes. You know, there are only a handful of larger concrete structures like schools and train stations. And so people, of course, crowd into those. And of course, they provide initial safety because, you know, the concrete and rebar walls and whatnot. But as the heat rises, and the glass in the windows and the doors begins to melt. And then the sparks start coming in. And suddenly, you know, an auditorium full of people, and they brought with them their bedding and their, you know, few belongings. And of course, the fires then penetrate inside there, and the sparks do. the hair starts to burn. The hallways and the staircases begin functioning like chimneys. And so the superheated air is rushing through there. And of course, you know, literally at the end, I mean, the day after, you find auditoriums that are filled with nothing but ashes and bones because of that. And of course, large open spaces, parks, the banks of the Sumida River are much the same. The dead grass there, because it's March, erupts in fires. People jump into the river. I mean, in the shallower waters, the water begins to boil. I mean, it's just, there's really almost nowhere in Tokyo that is safe in this kind of firestorm. Of course, temperatures, they're all over the place, but they range as high as 2,800 degrees. Hot enough that American investigators afterwards were able to find spots where literally concrete had melted. Imagine sliding boards and playgrounds warping, coins fusing together in people's pockets. I mean, so it really is just, you know, the asphalt turning into goo, you know, so that your shoes get stuck as you're trying to flee. So, I mean, it really is just an absolutely terrifying experience for those people on the ground.
And James,
it's just this massive raid that's unleashed by this. And of course, I mean, you chronicle the human cost really well in Black Snow, and we're running out of time for this segment. But, you know, James, what kind of struck me about this from a military standpoint, Curtis LeMay is a two-star general. From ground forces perspective, he would be in command of a division, maybe a corps. And not that that isn't a lot of power, but that kind of pales in comparison with controlling the strategic air forces in theater. You know what I mean? I mean, did that strike you too? You mentioned his youth.
Yeah, no, it totally does. And he kind of benefits from the fact that there's sort of this like loophole in the command structure set up out there, because Hap Arnold sets up the 20th Air Force, which is under his direct control. So Hap Arnold essentially is the head general of the 20th Air Force, which is going to execute the air war against Japan. And so Arnold then reports directly to the Joint Chiefs. And of course, LeMay is running the 21st Bomber Command as sort of Arnold's agent. And of course, Arnold then has a massive heart attack. You know, I think it's his fourth of the war at that point. And so he's out. And so LeMay is basically corresponding with Arnold's chief of staff, who's a brigadier general, Lars Norstad. And it's just basically the two of them. And he's outside the chain of command. So he doesn't report to Chester Nimitz. He doesn't report to Douglas MacArthur, the other big theater commanders there. He's kind of out there in the Mariana Islands running his own air war in so many ways. And that's one of the most astonishing things there. So when he makes this decision that we're going to burn Tokyo, he doesn't tell anybody. You know, he does that on purpose. And he cryptically asks Larry Norstad, he said, you know, has Hap Arnold a gambling kind of guy? I mean, he'd go for something unorthodox. And Norstad's like, you know, anything that'll win the war, Arnold would support. And he goes, all right, green light. But he decides, I'm going to keep Arnold out of this because I know he's convalescing in Florida. And I'm going to make this decision in part because if I'm wrong, then they can just fire me and Arnold can do it on his own. So he waits and he does cryptically tell Norstad, he's like, I think you need to come out to the Mariana Islands. He sends him a couple messages to that effect. And so Norstad decides to fly out. He's flying out as LeMay's planning this huge operation. And the first message LeMay sends back to Washington about what he's about to do is literally right before the bombers are going to take off. And he sends this telegram back. And he says, tonight's operations are going to be entirely different. It's just, when you read it, it just gives you chills. I mean, he's basically saying that at that point, the die has been cast. And so it really is this extraordinary story.
You read it in retrospect, and we know what happened. It's kind of chilling, actually.
It is. I mean, yeah, I feel like for sure. Thinking about it. So
yeah. Well, this has just been terrific. I appreciate your perspective, James. It's great to explore this with you. Thanks so much.
Thanks, John.
John Long, tell us about our veteran.
Today on our We Salute You feature, we honor the service of Oscar Cavallin, a paratrooper and a prisoner of war who exemplified so much of what we honor about the World War II generation. Born in Mississippi in 1921, Oscar enlisted in 1940 to train as a paratrooper. He earned his jump wings on the 4th of July, 1942, and was assigned to Company B, 507th Parachute Infantry Regiment, 82nd Airborne Division, as an intelligence specialist. On D-Day, Cavallin and his buddies jumped into France against great odds. And while Oscar survived D-Day, 10 days later, he was captured by the Germans and taken on a harrowing journey to Stalag 2A, north of Berlin, not far from what had been the Polish border. He later described, quote, inhuman beatings, forced hard labor, daily interrogations, and more beatings, probably due to his status as an intelligence operator. In early 1945, Oscar's camp was liberated by the advancing Russian army, and in the bitterly cold winter made another march, this time across Poland. But this time, he was moving closer to freedom. Family tradition says his trek took him all the way to Odessa on the Black Sea, a distance of some 1,100 miles. After the war, Oscar exemplified the qualities that made the greatest generation so great. Despite suffering physical infirmities from his POW experience, Oscar worked hard, becoming a rancher and a lawman in Texas. He seldom spoke of the war and never drew attention to himself or his heroic service. Oscar died of a heart attack in 1997 and was buried in Olivia, Texas, but he remains a legend in that community and within his family. Not long ago, some of his relatives visited the National D-Day Memorial to pay tribute. One nephew summed up Oscar's life this way, quote, Uncle Oscar was, I'm sure you can imagine, one tough dude. Staff Sergeant Oscar Cavallin, we salute you. Thank you for your service, and thank you for doing your part to save the world.
Well, absolutely one tough dude. I mean, the 507th was a hard fighting outfit and a hard luck outfit in some ways. And not only was he lucky to survive combat in Normandy, he was lucky to make it home because the number of people who had that POW odyssey going to Odessa or wherever disappeared inside the Soviet maw and never made it home. It's amazing stuff. Thanks so much, John. It's been such a pleasure to have you here with us today. Thank you so much for your perspective. I appreciate it.
And we invite
John, thanks so much for having
me. We invite you to come to the memorial anytime. It's we'd love to have you here in person, and your books are extraordinary. I encourage everyone to read Black Snow. It's really eye-opening. So thank you for that.
Thank you. Love to.
Absolutely. And James, a terrific speaker too. So it's a remarkable book. So thanks again, James. You can email our team at podcast@dday.org. If you're enjoying our discussions on World War II and its lasting impact, subscribe to this podcast, share it with your friends, rate it, and leave us a review. We love hearing from you. Love to get that feedback. So help us share the lessons and legacies of D-Day and World War II. Thanks so much.
Someone Talked is a production of the National D-Day Memorial Foundation in partnership with Watts Creative Studios. Views expressed are not necessarily those of the foundation. This program was supported by a grant from Virginia Humanities. Virginia Humanities connects people and ideas to explore the human experience and inspire cultural engagement. As the State Humanities Council, Virginia Humanities reaches millions in its estimated annual audience through festivals, grants, fellowships, digital initiatives, teacher institutes, radio programs, podcasts, apprenticeships, and school programs. Headquartered at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville, Virginia Humanities works to serve Virginians in every corner of the Commonwealth. To learn more, visit virginiahumanities.org. Located in Bedford, Virginia, the community that suffered the highest known D-Day loss per capita in the United States, Congress warranted the establishment of the nation's monument to D-Day in this emblematic American homefront. Receiving no federal or state funding, the memorial is operated and maintained by a private foundation and donor support. Explore the National D-Day Memorial, plan your visit, and learn more about upcoming events at dday.org. Join the conversation, email our team at podcast@dday.org.
It's no military secret that I love you.
Hey, how about romancing?
If you can keep a secret.
Well, can I take you dancing?
If you'll take my heart and keep it, I'm not saying a word. I'm careful whatever I do.
I guess everyone's heard. I wanna give all my love to you.
If you gotta talk to someone, don't give any information. It's smart to be a dumb one. Simply change the conversation.
Let's talk about love.
That's what I'm thinking of.
It's no secret, no secret. It's no secret that I love you.